So again, as of all the previous lecture, I will be merely descriptive. So see this lecture more as a teaser for people working in analytic number theory to invest the ADELIC setting, because I believe there are a good deal of ideas from analytic number theory, which can be transposed with great profit into ADELIC setting. So, okay. So recall you what we want to do. So we have, so driven by Duke's theorem, we have an orthogonal group, and what I will say can be more general. So we have then an ADELIC space. And so what I explained last time was that this ADELIC space is endowed with so let me call it G between brackets, and it admits a measure which is given as a quotient of the R measure on that group divided by the discrete measure on this discrete subgroup. So call it R. And in that case, this R measure is so this quotient measure is right invariant. And so I did not say it, and finite. And so then we can normalize it to be a probability. And so what I explained last time was that when the quadratic form is anisotropic, this quotient is in fact compact, so there is no surprise that the measure is finite. But in fact, this is true in greater generality, and this is the so-called Borel-Darisch-Chandra finiteness theorem. Okay, no, it may not be always finite. So it's finite unless n is 2 and q is isotropic. Q is, I would say, isotropic over the rationals. But yeah, but in that case, the orthogonal group is isomorphic, but then the orthogonal group is isomorphic to the multiplicative group, and then so the ADELIC point of the multiplicative group is just so which is just so GL1 of A. So this is just the unit of the ADELs, of the ring of ADELs, so called IDELs. And then you see that this quotient it's isomorphic to R star modulo GL1 of Z, which is Z star, so which is the multiplicative group of positive real numbers. So this here, the R measure is of course not finite, but it is the only case. Okay, so and here we will work mainly when Q is of rank greater than 2. And okay, I will explain if there is some small problem. And so we have this thing, and then we have a subgroup, so the stabilizer of a rational point. And we want to, so then we have also the quotient. So then this H will be is an orthogonal group in n minus one variable. So it may be that the measure is finite, but and we will assume that so that H so that Q restricted to the orthocomplement of X is anisotropic. Or that n is greater than free, and when we have no problem. So then we have again a finite R measure. And so we want to take a function, say continuous compactly supported function on G. For our problem, we ask that this function is invariant by the stabilizer of the lattice we are interested in. And we want to show that the integral of phi along H, along this H orbit, so actually we have to add a small adelic element which depend on our choice of this real point X naught and of the lattice L prime in which XQ sits. And so integrate this, and we want to show that this is converging to the integral of the function, but along the full group. And even, so here in the set, so even we may assume that the integral of phi equal zero, because when phi is a constant function, this is obvious because both measures are normalized to be probability measures. So we may even restrict to that case. So this is so we want under this condition we want to show that this integral converges to zero as d grows plus additional condition that were mentioned in the first lecture. Okay, so I want now to describe this space. And so maybe, so just recollection on quadratic space. Of low rank. So just will be useful because in a sense the most interesting case for this problem are the low, so the hardest cases are the low rank cases. So remind you that so when n is 2 and if you have so a quadratic space of rank 2, then a quadratic space of rank 2 is always similar, so which means isometric up to a scalar. It's always similar to a quadratic space of the shape k times the norm of k for k some quadratic étal algebra. So, which means simply that either k is q times q or a quadratic field. And nr is just the norm of this étal algebra, which so is the norm on the quadratic field, or the product on, or the coordinates if you are in this situation. So and then you can also compute what is the orthogonal group. Then SOQ, let's say, will be isomorphic to the algebraic group. So it's the algebraic of elements of K of norm 1. So, and simply, the action is you have lambda in K, so non-zero element, and you take X in K, and then if you consider the map X gives lambda X, then this is orthogonal similitude of similitude factor, the norm of lambda. So this is the rank 2 case. So if you are in rank 3, a ternary quadratic space is always so similar to a ternary space of the shape B naught of NRB, where B is either, so is a is a, so degree 4 central simple algebra over Q, but meaning that B is either the algebra of 2x2 matrices or a quaternion algebra, over Q, so NR is the norm, so in that case, the norm is just the determinant. Oh, okay, so B naught, this is the subspace of trace zero element. And the quadratic form Q is just either the determinant if you are in the matrix case or the norm of the quaternion algebra. Let's say Z gives Z times the involution of the quaternion algebra. So you have this description, and you have also a nice description of the orthogonal group. So SOQ, it's isomorphic to the so to the this is the algebraic group of associated to the invertible element, so the unit of B. And here this is the center, so you take the quotient of this group by the scalar quaternion. So I will write it P B star. So it's an algebraic group whose points over Q are just the element of the Q, so the element of the algebra, the invertible element of the algebraic set divided by the scalar element. And so maybe, yeah. And the action is given by this. So if you have, W in B-star, and if you take an element of trace 0, then you have you associate to this element its conjugate, W Z W minus 1, and then you get a new trace 0 quaternion whose norm is the norm of Z. And maybe I should say, so for n is 4, there is an analogous description. So in terms of either you have the quaternary space given by a quaternion algebra equipped with its norm, or so this is if the discriminant of Q is a square, and if it's not a square, then you have a description which I will write bk plus times the norm, where k is the quadrat. Okay, it's slightly false, but let me. It's q of, in fact, of the square root of a multiple of the discriminant. So if no, in fact, it's right. And so bk is and bk plus is a certain four-dimensional subspace inside bk. And we equip this space with the norm. And then any quaternary quadratic space is similar to one of these two spaces. In fact, if you want to take K to be the split quadratic algebra, so which is what you would get, you have this description is valid uniformly whether the discriminant is a square or not. And you have the orthogonal group SOQ can be described in terms of bk star of the action of this algebra of quaternions over k. So this is standard. I think you can find this in Kitaoka's book on quadratic form. So and the proof goes by considering the Clifford algebra associated to any of these quadratic space, and so it's classical. But so it's just to mention that for low rank quadratic space, so what will come up, a central object will be quaternion algebra and groups associated to quaternion algebra. So automorphic forms. So I go back now that one has an idea of what the structure of G is. Automorphic forms on G or on GA are nice functions on the quotient GA modulo GQ. And I want to give examples maybe of automorphic forms for various kind of groups. So just to have an idea, examples. So let's take so G, okay. Let's take the case of So the additive group modulo Q, so it can be realized can identify it with Na over NQ, where N is the group of unipotent matrices. So you have, okay, and I recall you have A mod Q mod Z at, which is identified with R mod Z as an additive group. And so then if you take a character of this circle group, then because you have this identification, this psi of n correspond to additive character on A mod Q, which is trivial on Z hat. And maybe we just work out what happens exactly. So if you let us compute, so consider XR in R inside A. So then you have, by definition, psi n of XR is E of n XR. But what does it give if you compute against other elements? So now if you take XP in QP, so then your XP, you can decompose it so you take the p-adic expansion. Okay, so here this is an element of ZP, and this is an element of Q because it's a finite. So okay, AK. This is an element of Q, and in that case, let's take phi n of XP. Then it's defined by exactly as E of minus n of the so-called the fractional part of this p-adic element. And of course, Zp being contained into Zp hat, if you evaluate psi n against this element, you just get one. Okay, so the way, the reason for this computation is because you know that your character is trivial on Z hat, and also it has to be trivial on Q, on the Q embedded diagonally. Maybe I want also to do another example, so which is now, it's me do G is GL1, so G of A is A star. And so we have that this identification, G of A modulo G of Q modulo G of Z hat. It's identified with So So in other terms, if you give yourself a character of the multiplicative group of the positive real number, automatically you will get a character on this quotient, so on A star modulo Q star, which will be trivial over the at star. And so the characters of A star will be so. They are all of the shape they are just the absolute value the real absolute value to some power. And so once you give one of these, you obtain a character on this quotient. And so what is this character precisely? This character, A star is given by the following formula. So you take now an adelic element, invertible, and you map it to the following function, to the power s, which is, by definition, the product over all, times the product over all prime of the p-adic absolute value of the p component to the power s. And so you verify that in that way you obtain a character which is which will be trivial on q star and trivial on z at star and of the right shape. So this character, here. So the product of all the absolute values over all the components is called the modulus character, or the adelic modulus. So this is another example of automorphic form on, so, and here you are on this quotient. So other examples are given by Dirichlet characters. And, okay, so what, so suppose you have a Dirichlet character. So then you have the following isomorphism. So you can show that it's just is the same kind of reasoning, but it's isomorphic to A star modulo Q star modulo K F Q, with K F Q is what we called previously the principal congruent subgroup, so it's 1 plus q z at star, or if you prefer, it's the product over all primes not dividing q of the zp star times the product over all primes dividing q of 1 plus q zp. So, and this is a multiplicative subgroup of Z star, and its index is precisely the cardinality of that. And so, in that way, from any Dirichlet character, you obtain qui, multiplicative Dirichlet caractère, gives nadelic caractère of A star mod Q star, which will be trivial on this open compact subgroup. And in fact, you have a bijective map between Dirichlet characters are in bijection with finite order characters of A star modulo Q star. Sorry?
Where are the reals?
The reals. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Plus.
Yeah. Okay, and now if you want to obtain all the characters of this quotient of A star modulo Q star, what you have to do is to multiply a finite order adelic character with a character of that shape, and then you get all description of all. Okay, and I will finish the example on that board. Now if you go further, if you take a finite extension of Q, a field, then this field defines an algebraic group, torus, which I know TK, which is a subtorus of the linear transformation of K, so views as a Q vector field. And simply the action is given by x in k and lambda in k star. You have this linear map, give lambda x. So k star acts linearly on k by multiplication, and the k star is a group of rational points of some torus inside this GLK, so which you may seen as belonging to GLNQ by choosing a Q basis of K. So, okay, in fancy terms, TK is the restriction from K to Q, of scalar from K to Q of the multiplicative group. And what happens is that Ecke characters, so classical Ecke characters of K, correspond bijectively to so continuous characters of TKA modulo TKQ. And so when you look at, say, Ziegle lecture or Ecke's lecture on the definition of Ecke character, usually it's a big mess because your character has to satisfy some condition you have a lot of conditions of your character, and these conditions are made to ensure that your corresponding adelic character is trivial on the rational element. And finally, last example, which will be, F in SK of SL2Z est que eigenform then for you f of gamma z equals g of gamma z to the k f of z. And so how does one associate to this Secker eigenform an automorphic form? So we observe that the quotient H mod SL2Z is identified with, so this is what Valentin explained in a much more general context. So, and simply this map is given by G goes to, let's say, G I gamma. So you have this identification, and and let me write this here as PGL2R modulo PGL2Z modulo PSO2R. And here I can identify this with an Adélie quotient PGL2A modulo PGL2Q, and here modulo PSO2R times PGL2Z hat. Okay, sorry, it's getting very, very small. So, okay, you have this identification of the modular surface with an Adélie quotient, so of PGL2 by the rational points, and on the right, you have the product of the compact group, compact real group by this compact finite Adélie subgroup. And now, and so how do I associate a function on that quotient? Then it is because of all this identification, it suffices to define a function not exactly on that quotient, but so to my function modular form f of z, I associate f tilde of g defined by G of so it's a function on the group, and so what you can check is that you can check that for all gamma in in GL2Z, f tilde of gamma g is f tilde of g. It's a positive determinant, just to for this to be well defined. So then it means that f tilde is a function on and it's not a function on exactly this double quotient, but if you look at what happens, so let's take kappa, a matrix. So where the angle theta is only defined modulo p, and then if you look at f tilde of g kappa, what you obtain is that it will be e minus k of kappa of f tilde of g, where e minus k of kappa is e of minus k of theta. So k is even and theta is defined modulo p, so this is well defined. And so this, so e minus, this e minus k of kappa is a character of PSO2R. So what you get from a holomorphic weight k modular form is a function on this quotient, which transforms in a special way under the right action of this compact real subgroup. And so in that way, you see that you obtain from F tilde gives you, so F tilde defines a function on modulo PGL2 z hat, transforming which is an eigenfunction for the right action of PSO2R. And the eigenvalue for this action in this is this character, which is determined by the weight. Okay. And if your modular form is a Hecke eigenform, then the F tilde will be a genuine automorphic form. Okay. So I return now to G is SO2Q, and so we want to understand the space of say of continuous function on this quotient. And we would like to understand the function which are moreover invariant by some open compact subgroup. And for this, it's in fact the starting point is to understand first the L2 space. And this L2 space is so unitary representation of G of A for the right action multiplication. So simply, so if you have a function and you have a G phi, it's a new function which to G prime associate phi of G prime G. So you see, if your function is a function on GA which is GQ invariant, this new function will still remain GQ invariant. And the representation is unitary. So simply because the measure that is taken here is R measure, which is right invariant. And And so the main thing to do, so and so, okay, one thing which is good is that also, which is why, okay. Okay, in fact, you can upgrade this from a representation of GA, and this is a standard thing, to a representation of an algebra, say, for instance, the algebra of continuous compactly supported function of GA, so with the product replaced by the convolution. So simply, if you take a function continuous compactly supported, okay, the f is not the same f as a modular form, but if you take such a function, you can define the operator. And so, just by this convolution trick, so if suppose that your continuous function, which is a function on this product, is written as a product of a function on GR times a function over the on G on the finite adels. Yeah, and suppose that this function is smooth, and this function here, for instance, suppose you take that it is a characteristic function of a principal congruent subgroup, so this small neighborhood of the identity which is an open compact subgroup, then RF phi will be smooth. In the so-called JR variable, KF right invariant in the GF variable. So by this convolution trick, your L2 space of functions which are just measurable is generated but by very nice smooth functions. Okay, so basically it's... So then if you understand the L2 space, you will also understand very well the smooth functions, which is really what we need in this, and the continuous functions. And, okay, also, should say that the Ecke operators have an adelic description. So which is the following, so for p sufficiently large, then you can define the gp in g of qp, then you can define the Ecke operator tp, t of gp, to be the operator, the convolution operator associated to the following, to the characteristic function of the double class And so, for again, if P is sufficiently large, the algebra, this algebra of operator will be commutative and made of normal. Of normal, even in that case, if G is an orthogonal group, self-adjoint operators. And Ecke, as because these are Ecke operators, Ecke eigenform, so for, say, PG, for classical Ecke eigenform, will be, the corresponding function will be eigenform for the family of all such Ecke operators. Okay, so I don't have much time, but I will try to explain what is. And so now I can write, okay, suppose that Q is anisotropic and n is greater than 3, which is our case of interest. Then, so this representation decomposes into an orthogonal sum of irreducible representations. And so this orthogonal sum is following. So cusp, where, so this part is very simple to describe. It's a direct sum of one-dimensional vector spaces. It's chi composed with the norm. So let's say Q is anisotropic, which means that the I recall you, the ternary space is correspond to a quaternion algebra. Condition. So this space is this, and chi, this function is, so you have a character, so chi, it's a character on the idels. Finite order. And so this function is a function with two g in, let's say, b star of A goes to chi of the, so g corresponds to a quaternion. So you take the norm of this quaternion, adelic quaternion, you compose with the character, and you obtain a function. Okay, so, and this, here you, this is an infinite sum over all the Ecke characters which can live there, or which are, say, define the non-trivial thing here. No, okay. And, okay, L2 cuspidal is an orthogonal sum where P are, so infinite dimensional representations, infinite dimensional, so unitary representation of GL of A. And But this representation are of quite a special type because they are made, so they admit the realization made of vectors which are functions which are invariant of G of A. And so these representations are the so infinite dimensional cuspidal representations of GA. So these are all, not all the unitary representation of that group would be too big, but so if Q is isotropic, you have a third component coming from Eisenstein series. So then, okay, and so then we are interested in the V pi, which admits in the pi or the V pi, which admits G of L hat, right, invariant vectors. Okay, not all of them, and there are only finitely many. Not finitely many. And so, for such, either the finite dimensional ones or the infinite ones. So now, to study, so this integral that we want to study this convergence, we may assume that phi belongs to one of the that phi is either of the shape chi composed with the norm, or phi belongs to one of these v pi. And so then you have a different situation. So this case is relatively easy. So I will do the first case. So we are looking at the integral along H of chi of, say, norm of H. And then there is a G X naught L prime dH. So this, you can factor out this term. And so we are left just with this integral. In a sense, we would like to show that this thing goes to zero when d is sufficiently large. Okay. So what happens, and so for key, of course, for key, not trivial. Not the trivial character. So then what can happen is that, just to exist, this key has to be of order 2. So then is associated to some quadratic field, because it's a character of order 2, so it corresponds to a quadratic Dirichlet character, and so corresponds to a quadratic field. So, and what happens is that if H, which I have recalled in the beginning, is associated to a quadratic field, to the same quadratic field, so then it will imply that chi of the norm on H will be a constant equal to 1. And so therefore, this integral won't be 0. So then this explains the exclusion from the theorem of exceptional square classes for D, because the D determines the quadratic field and this is bad because we would like the integral to converge to 0. So, and just in a milli, so I'm very late, so I finish with just the remaining case. So now, if phi is in V pi, is contained in L2 cusp. So then there is a formula of Waldspurger. And phi plus phi is nice. It's nice. But we may assume that then there is a formula of Waldspurger, which tells you the following. So the integral we are interested in square, and so can be returned up to a constant as an L function of a modular form plus a sort of finite product. Okay, we'll not write what this is. For F, Ecker eigenform, not necessarily holomorphic, Ecker eigenform with the same eigenvalues Ecker at pi for almost every pi. And this is just the Ecke L function of f, and the Ecke L function of f time key. And this is the value of the quadratic of a quadratic character attached to d times d to the 1/2. And so, so the fact that this integral over h goes to zero is follows among other things to the following bound. So which is called, of course, a subconvex bound plus bounds for this things that I have not written and no time to describe here, but which are much easier to get. So, of course, I could have formulated everything in Adélie terms, no time anymore. So, so this is a so-called subconvex bound. And so such a bound was obtained for the first time by Ivaniec for holomorphic forms, from which Duke could treat a great deal of ternary quadratic forms. And then Duke extended Ivaniec's bound to other kind of standard form, mass forms, and so on. And so then, together with Schulze-Pillow, then they could get a more general result, in particular as a principle. So when the D was square free. So to remove the square free assumption, then you have to deal with these local things that I have not described. And here, in that case, maybe this, I should say that now there is a purely Adélie treatment of these L functions, which is due to Venkatesh, which works over general number fields. So in that way, you get the theorem that I have stated about ternary forms for over general number fields. Okay, it's over time, so thank you.
Okay. Any questions or comments? Yes?
I have a question about what's on the board behind that board about the appearance of the continuous spectrum or not. So I'm probably just confused about translating something from the classical picture to this picture. If Q is anisotropic, I thought whether or not the continuous spectrum shows up or not depends on whether G is compact or not.
Yes, exactly.
But if Q is anisotropic, it could fail to be isotropic just at a finite place, but the group could still be non-compact, and then.
No, so if Q is anisotropic is anisotropic Q over the rational numbers. So you could be isotropic at a real place or at some other finite place, but the global quotient GM modulo GQ will be compact, and then its spectrum will be discrete. So, because all these operators, these RF, will be compact operators. So the condition is that. To have Eisenstein series is that you are isotropic, and if you consider more general group, it means that your group contains a rational unipotent element, and then the Eisenstein series come from these unipotent elements.
Other question? Maybe a comment. Can you give a few references for people?
Oh. Okay, yeah, okay, so maybe references, so for, okay, so for analytic number theorists, maybe if you want to get used to ADELs, maybe just to start, I would suggest there is a recent paper of Browning and Pankaj Vichai, who was there last week, who said adelic circle method. So there is no automorphic form. The only automorphic form that could appear are the additive characters over the adels that I have described. So that's an intro. So because they prove an analog of a theorem of Skinner on finding points on cubic varieties in don't know, maybe 9 or 10 variables over number fields. So then to have a presentation of automorphic forms over the adels, I would start with the book of Gelbart at Princeton University Press, so which is really a gentle book with, at the end, a very nice application. And then I would follow this up with the book of Bump at Cambridge, and maybe there are also the book of Goldfeld, which could be okay. Now, if you want to enter into the analytic number theory that enters into this proof, now there is no book yet, but I would suggest Akshay paper. I think it's something like 205 in Annals of Math. I forgot. There are nice books by Knightley and Lee. For instance, they have a manuscript who give an adelic treatment of the Kuznetsov trace formula. So if you do a classical modular form, this book is very interesting, very gentle. There are several books. And okay, so then you have Venkatesh, and if you want to look deeper into the subconvexity problem, then this is my paper and with Akshay. Which probably you can get from the staff at IHES. And okay, and then I should say maybe some small advertisement, a book in preparation. So the list of authors is not completely determined, but okay, so there is at least one author. And I hope more book in preparation on Duke's theorem. So I would say in general. And so you can find the first free chapter of that book on my webpage. And these free chapters describe more or less all what I have explained in this lecture. So the fourth chapter about the adels will come maybe soon, maybe in 1 or 2 weeks, and then there will be further chapters. Okay.
Okay. Then let's thank Philippe once more.